Hi, everybody. So in this topic, we covered a variety of things. The first one was using parentheses. The parentheses in a problem tell us what to do first. So in this problem, we are going to solve 7 minus 2 before we do the times 4 part, compared to this one, where 4 times 7 is the first step, and then minus 2 follows. And what we're going to look at right now is how those are different. So I'm just going to slide that down so we have a little more workspace. And if we take a look at this first problem, if we do 7 minus 2 first, that's an easy one I can do mentally. 7 minus 2 is 5. And then I still have to multiply by 4. This becomes 4 times 5. And if I count by 5s, 4 times, 5, 10, 15, 20... I see that that's 20. Pretty straightforward. This one, on the other hand, is a little bit different. I have to first solve 4 times 7, because that's what's in the parentheses. If I count by 7s, 7, 14, 21, 28, I know that 4 times 7 is 28. And I still have to do minus 2. And again, that's pretty easy mentally. 28 minus 2, I count back 2, is 26. So, pretty straightforward example where we see that sometimes the parentheses, the placement of the parentheses, totally changes the problem. So here, it's the same numbers, the same operations. We had 4 times 7 minus 2, 4 times 7 minus 2, but where I place the parentheses totally changes the answer. So the main thing to remember is whatever you do in parentheses, you do first. Or whatever is in parentheses, you do first. And what I've done here is I just wrote below, and to make sure I kept everything in the right spots, and solved it step by step. Now in this problem, we have the same sort of setup, where we have the same numbers, the same operations, with the parentheses moved, so we know we do them in a different order. But what we're going to see here is that multiplication has a special property called the associative property. Let's take a look and just see what happens first. Okay, step by step here, I start with the parentheses. 3 times 2 is 6, times 4. I count by 6 is 4 times, 6, 12, 18, 24. See that 6 times 4 is 24. Now here, I do parentheses first. So 2 times 4 equals 8. And it's I have to multiply that by 3. So 3 times 8, I'm going to count by 8s. 8, 16, 24. Whoa, look at that. Okay. So what I'm seeing is that even though I moved the parentheses on this one, it's still 24 either way. Now, that's because of the associative property of multiplication. Unlike the problem we just looked at, when it's all multiplication, it doesn't matter where the parentheses go. We can do it in any order. Multiplication is very special this way, and we can use that to help us with some things, and that's what we're going to look at next. So what I have here is a 3 by 14 array. Now, I could write that as 3 times 14 equals something. We haven't studied times 14s. In fact, we're not going to study times 14s. But what we did learn is how to use another strategy to simplify this problem. And it's going to relate back to the idea that we can use the associative property of multiplication to regroup things in different ways. So, first thing I want to notice is that I can take this and break this apart like so. So what did I do? I took that big 3 by 14 array and I broke it into mini arrays. If I zoom in on them, and I look at just one of them, I have a
2x3 array. This little array is 2x3. How many of those do I have? Let's zoom out again. I have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 of those mini arrays. So I could say that I have a 2x3 array times 7. Now let's compare this with something. Let's look back at this 3x14. I could take 3x14. 14, I know, is 2x7. And remember, I still am multiplying the whole thing by 3. So I have 2x7 × 3. Now, multiplication, we said it doesn't matter what order we do these things in. So I can use the associative property to rearrange this into doing 3x2 first and times 7. And then to make it actually totally match what I have up there, I'm going to use the commutative property, 2x3 × 7. So these are all going to equal the same thing. Now, let's take a look back up here at the array, because I know this is starting to look a little confusing, but let's narrow our focus back to this. I have these 7 mini arrays of 2x3. Well, 2x3 is 6, so, and it's easy to see that there's 6 in each of these little mini arrays, so it's really 6x7. If I can count either by 6s or by 7s, I think I'm going to count by 7, 6 times, 7, 14, 21, 28, 35, 42. So 6x7 = 42. And if I count, I'll see that there are 42 there. And 3x14 = 42. So what's the point of all this? The point of this is I can take a more complicated problem, like 3x14, and use these special properties of multiplication to divide it up and rearrange it into a more solvable problem. 6x7 is going to equal the same thing as 3x14. The last thing that we focused on was multiplying by 8. And we're going to look at some different ways to think about multiplying by 8, and then we're going to talk about some strategies to make this all easier. So first of all, I have here a 7x8 array, or 8x7. I have 7 rows with 8 in each. Now, we're getting up to numbers where that's a lot to count up. So, how can I make this easier on myself? One thing I can do is I can break this into parts. Times 5s are always friendly, so I'm going to break my array here, because what I'm noticing is that that is 5 in a row. So what is this part of the array? This part of the array, I have 7 rows still, but there are 5 in each part. And what about this part of the array? Well, it's also become friendlier because there are 7 rows, but there are 3 in each part. And if I add those together, I know it'll be the same as the whole array on its own. So, let's give ourselves a little workspace. If I have 7x5, and I add that to 7x3, now remember, I'm putting these in parentheses to tell me what to do first, it should give me whatever 7x8 is. That's a terrible looking 8. Okay, there we go. 7x8. So, how do we solve this? Well, we talked about this just a moment ago. 7x5, well, I can count by 5s. That's the whole point of breaking it into a 5s fact and something else. So 5, 10, 15, 20, 25, 30, 35. That was 7 5s. Plus 7x3. I could count by 3 7 times, or count by 7s 3 times. I'm going to count by 7s. 7, 14, 21. So this becomes 35 plus 21. I can do a little side math if I'm not sure. 50. Whoop, I just gave away the answer. 35 plus 21. I start with the 1s. 5 plus 1 is 6. 3 10s plus 2 10s is 5 10s, so it's 56. I could have also have broken it the other way. I could, instead of breaking it like that, I can't get that out of there. So just bear with me. I could have gone down this way and created 5 rows of 8 and 2 rows of 8, and it would still work the same way. So the blue line is going to kind of be in our way here. I'm going to erase it out of there. Just imagine all the X's are still there. And so what I would have now is 5 rows of 8, or 5 times 8, plus this, which is 2 rows of 8, or 2 times 8. I'm having trouble writing the number 8 today for some reason. 8. So then my math would look like this. 5 times 8 plus 2 times 8. Oop, can't forget my parentheses, equals, again, 7 times 8. That's kind of ugly there. I'm going to put it on the other side for neatness, because remember, it doesn't matter which side of things the equal sign, which side of the equal sign you put things on, because it all just means that they are the same. So 5 times 8 is 40, plus 2 times 8, which is 16. 40 plus 16 equals 56. So no matter how you slice it, it's still going to end up the same. The same is true of division. 72 divided by 8. That seems tricky unless we have our multiplication facts memorized. So what I want to do is I want to break this into an easy fives fact, because then I can put it back together and make my life simpler. So I'm doing 8s, so I know 40 is going to be my easy 5s fact, because 5 times 8 is 40. So I can break that into 40 divided by 8, and I can't forget about the rest of 72. 40 and 32 make 72, so I know the other part is going to be 32 divided by 8. And I know this seems confusing, but really all I'm doing is I'm taking the number 72 and I'm dividing into two parts, 40 and 32. But I'm not interested in that so much, because I want to divide 72 divided by 8, so I'm making sure that I'm dividing those parts by 8 as well. Much like when I was looking at my array here, everything is still times 8, everything is still divided by 8 over here. So I can do the same thing. 40 divided by 8, I know that equals 5. That's the easy 5s fact, because 8 times 5 equals 40. 32 divided by 8, I know that one is 4, because let's count by 4 8s to show why. 8, 16, 24, 32. So that took me 4 8s to make 32, so 32 divided by 8 equals 4. Now, a number bond is always showing parts. This and this are the two parts of this. So that means to find out what this is going to be, I have to add these together. So 5 plus 4 equals 9. So 72 divided by 8 equals 9. The very last thing we did is we looked at some word problems using 8s, and specifically we also looked at word problems that had two parts to them. But before we do that, I want to just focus on one thing quick, which is creating a count by eights. I went over in detail with sixes and sevens. With the eights, we're just going to create the count by together. But you use the same strategy. You add on eight each time, and you can either count up or use a mental math strategy. But it's important to become fast at making these, so that you can create one whenever you need one. So let's make one together. We're going to count by eights. I want you to count with me if you can. 8. Now, the next one is 8 plus 8, so 16. And then add another 8, 24. Each time, I'm adding another 8. So 8, 16, 24. Add another 8, 32. 40. That's our friendly fives fact, because look, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 5 groups of 8 equals 40. That's one to memorize. Add another 8, that's an easy one, that's 48. Add another 8, 56. One more, 64. Add 8, 72. Add another 8 for 80. So, count. Practice counting. Pause this and practice counting by eights if you haven't memorized it yet. It's really important. I hope you really did practice it. All right, now, let's do a word problem together. Let's read this problem together. Leo earns $8 each week for doing chores. After 7 weeks, he buys a gift and has $38 left. How much money does he spend on the gift? This is going to take us 2 steps. The first step is to figure out how much money he had after he worked for the 7 weeks. So, let's draw a tape diagram. There's my tape diagram. I know he's been working for 7 weeks, so I'm going to make 7 boxes. So I'm going to add, actually, 6 lines. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Okay, so that's 7 boxes. 1 is each week. Each week, he earned $8. I'm going to add those right in there. And the question is, how much, well, this is my first question, is how much did he earn altogether? After I figure that out, there's going to be another step. So the next step is going to be after he earned all that money, he spent some, and we want to find out how much he spent. That's the actual problem. What we know is that however much he spent, he has 38 left. So whatever this amount is how much he spent, because this is the amount of money he has left over. But we have to do this in 2 steps. So the first part of the problem is this top one. I have, looks to me like I have 7 groups with 8 in each. I'm going to write that as multiplication. 7 times 8, that's one I have memorized, but if you don't, you could flip back and count by 8s on the last page, like this. Let's do it together. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. That's why it's so handy to make that count by. So 7 times 8 equals 56. So we know he earned $56. So now I know that this whole tape diagram is worth 56 because that's the amount of money he had. So to solve the problem, I have to find out just what is the amount he spent is. So he had $56. And he spent, or he had left, $38. So I know that whatever he spent is going to be 56 minus 38. And make sure, let's do that together. I'm going to do it as side math over here. 56 minus 38. I've been seeing a lot recently people starting with the tens. Do not do that. Start with the ones in case you have to borrow. Ah, like we do here. 6 minus 8, I can't do that. So I'm going to borrow a 10, and then it becomes 16 minus 8, which is 8, and 4 minus 3, which is 1. So 18. So what does that 18 mean? That means that he spent $18. This is just one of many examples of 2-step word problems, and it's one using times eights, but it could appear anywhere. Whenever you're doing a word problem, it's really important to take a look and think about, is this 1 step or is it 2? I hope this video was helpful, and feel free to send me any questions that you have.